section of chapter 4. You couldn't get it all done in an hour if you tried, so we'll just kind of key in on verses 9, 10, and 11 today. So then there remains a Sabbath rest for the people of God. For whoever has entered God's rest has also rested from his works as God did from his. Let us therefore strive to enter that rest so that no one may fall by the same type of disobedience. This morning I want to look at the word Sabbath. It's a Hebrew word and it means rest. Now, we often think of Sabbath in connection with a certain day of the week because the third commandment given by God through Moses said, on the seventh day you shall do no labor, neither you nor your animals or your servants. Well, later on in the New Testament, God said through Paul, it's not which day that you do that, spend time with God, because by that time they had switched to the first day of the week as a reminder that it was on the first day of the week, Sunday, that Jesus was raised from the dead. And later on, when Luther wrote his explanation to the third commandment, he took it off of a day of the week. He says, truly, you could worship God any day, but the main point is, do you hear the word of God? In other words, are you listening to your Lord and applying that word to your life? Well, today, to kind of get a better handle on Sabbath, I'd like to use the term R&R. Now, most people, that means rest and relaxation. That's actually kind of a military term for time away from the base. But today we're going to look at some more R's than just rest and relaxation. There's a whole bunch of R's, though I'll try to not get all piratey on you. You might say that the first two R&Rs of what the Sabbath is all about is repentance and restoration. Those are key. Repentance means being turned around 180 degrees. Instead of going the wrong direction, turning around and going the correct direction. It takes the Holy Spirit to work that R, that repentance in us. All of us are born in a lost condition. That means every human being born of man and woman is born an enemy of God. We think that we're in charge. That's a very bad R&R there. We have a rebellion and a refusal to do things God's way. We want to be the center of the universe. We want to be the ones who call the shots, who are the captains of our destinies and our own souls. And then what do? When we're in charge? Well, we hate and we hurt and we're full of pride and lust and greed, and we end up alienating everybody else and being unhappy ourselves. And even if we persist in that till death comes worse than physical death, the everlasting destruction and torments and flames of hell, truly, we need to be turned off of that path, to be turned around. And that's why God uses his word to bring repentance. His word, given through prophets and apostles and evangelists, his word helps us see that by ourselves we're empty, we're broken, and we're powerless. No matter how hard we try to be good, no matter how much effort we put into it, it doesn't work. That's why the word rest comes into play, because we can't fix us. God does, first of all, by bringing us to repentance, helping us admit we need God, helping us admit we're broken so he can begin the restoration work of putting us back together in his image, of fixing us, or better than fixing us, of joining us, reattaching us to the one who made us to be in connection with him in the first place. The reattachment takes place as God uses his word again to tell us about the most important rest of all, the rest from the labors to save us. How did that take place? Well, it took place through that awful crucifixion. When Jesus willingly offered himself to die in our place that we might be washed clean of sin. Restoration means all that separated us from God is washed away. All the sin that we do and think and say, was cleansed by the pure and holy sacrificial blood of Jesus Christ. That makes all the difference in the world. It makes us alive. It brings us back to God. Instead of rejecting God, instead of resisting Him, we instead are reconnected. That's so important. Apart from Him, we have nothing. With Him, we become people of God. We become those full of His love and mercy and peace and joy, people who are heirs of heaven itself. God in our hearts, resting in them, ruling in them, reigning in them, makes us different people. We no longer are controlled by a fear of getting caught or fear of not being good enough. Instead, we've been rejuvenated. We've been given a life that never ends since the Spirit's put in us faith and reliance on Jesus Christ. And because of that, because of our Redeemer, we begin to offer our hearts back to God. When He reigns there and rules there, we begin to do things differently. Our life reflects our gratitude, our obedience, not what do I have to do, but Lord, what would show you that I am so thankful that you died and rose for me? That's why rest doesn't mean rust. You know what rust means, how that happens. You sit around, you do nothing, and you lose it all. God doesn't call us to rust in pieces, but to be rejuvenated and restored to rejoice in serving Him. To look at the gifts He's given us. Yes, the incomes. Yes, the voices that sing. Yes, the hands that comfort and console. And well, Saturday might break a neighbor's leaves, or you might lift up somebody else's gutters that have fallen down. You might lift up the heart of a sad person who's lost a loved one. What is the way that God will use you? I don't know this week, but I do know that if God lives in you, He will work through you. You become His hands and feet and His voice, because suddenly we people, for all of our sins and flaws, become reflectors. That's right, we aren't the originators or source of light, but the love of God that comes into us is reflected out to others. The forgiveness that He gives to us enables us to forgive others. The comfort, the strength, it comes to us and passes through us to others. And finally, they know who God is, not a terrible, evil, scary judge, but the Father who welcomes, who draws back, the Son who is the way, the Spirit who lives in us and rules over us. When we've been reclaimed by this Redeemer, we are altogether new. And then suddenly the rest means we're complete again. We're put together as people God wants us to be. It's a lifetime process. You never get over it. That's why we keep coming back and hearing God's word. Keep coming back and having the Lord's Supper. Keep coming back for fellowship to encourage each other and be encouraged. We need the Lord. And we rejoice that He wants us. We rejoice here in this earth in the labors of our hands. We rejoice in the forgiveness that we hear and spread. And one day we'll rejoice in heaven. There, the rest of the story will finally be visible to our eyes as we look upon our Redeemer, Savior, and King. God grant us that rest. Amen. And now may the peace of God that surpasses all human understanding keep your hearts and your minds through faith in Christ Jesus.